My name is Dave Loftus, and this is a presentation on cardiac tamponade. The learning objectives for today's talk will be to understand the causes of pericardial effusion, to recognize the signs and symptoms of cardiac tamponade, and to understand the treatment of cardiac tamponade. We will start the talk initially with a discussion on some of the causes of pericardial effusion. We will then discuss the pathophysiology of cardiac tamponade. We will discuss the signs and symptoms of tamponade, and finally discuss the treatment of cardiac tamponade. Cardiac tamponade is one result of a pericardial effusion, so that is where we'll start our discussion today. Pericardial effusion is the accumulation of fluid in the pericardial space surrounding the heart. There are many different causes of a pericardial effusion, several of which are listed above in the slide. There are several types of infections that can cause a pericardial effusion, including viral, bacterial, and fungal. HIV is one important infection that should be considered in a patient with the correct risk factors. Trauma, or any physical manipulation of the heart or pericardium, are also common causes of effusion. For example, every patient who undergoes a cardiac bypass graft with open heart surgery will get some sort of a pericardial effusion in the postoperative period. Other trauma to the heart, such as a stab wound, can also cause an effusion. In patients who have had a myocardial infarction, Dressler syndrome is a certain type of inflammatory reaction that can occur in the days to weeks following their infarction. Uremia will also cause an effusion in many instances. Many types of cancer can result in pericardial effusions. These effusions tend to be chronic and can be quite large at times. Rheumatologic and inflammatory processes such as lupus, vasculitis, amyloidosis, and sarcoidosis can also result in a pericardial effusion. And the presence of an effusion in the correct clinical scenario may help you diagnose some of these conditions. Certain drugs such as procainamide and hydralazine can also cause effusions. So how do you tell that a patient has a pericardial effusion? There are some diagnostic clues that can help point you to this diagnosis. An echocardiogram of the heart is certainly a very common way to diagnose an effusion and properly assess its size. However, you'll not always have an echocardiogram in every patient who comes into the hospital. On chest x-ray, a large pericardial effusion will basically look like cardiomegaly. Some radiologists, when they report cardiomegaly, will often say cardiomegaly and or pericardial effusion because usually these can't be distinguished on a simple plain film chest x-ray. The x-ray in the top right of the slide shows a very large, round-shaped heart due to a large pericardial effusion. This is often called a water bottle heart due to its globular appearance. A CT scan at the bottom of the slide shows a pericardial effusion more distinctly. The effusion is the darker gray surrounding the lighter colored heart. The black arrow in the figure is pointing to the pericardial fluid. Another classic diagnostic sign of pericardial effusion is electrical alternans. You will likely be tested on this at some point in your medical career, so make sure you learn this well. If you look at the bottom line of the EKG, which is the rhythm strip of lead 2, you'll notice that the height or amplitude of the QRS complex varies with each beat. Hence, the voltage is alternating, which is where the name comes from. The way I like to think of this is to imagine the heart swinging like a pendulum amongst a large volume of pericardial fluid. Therefore, the voltage sensed by the EKG lead on the surface of the chest will be different from beat to beat, since the heart will be closer or farther from the EKG lead as it swings through the fluid with each beat. So how does a pericardial effusion cause cardiac tamponade? Please note that these are not the same things. Tamponade is actually an urgent or emergent condition that can lead to cardiogenic shock and impair the heart's ability to pump blood to the rest of the body. It is due to a very large or a rapidly accumulating pericardial effusion that impairs the heart's ability to fill with fluid. As fluid accumulates in the pericardial space, it forces the pericardial membrane to stretch. If enough fluid accumulates, then the pericardial membrane cannot expand anymore, so additional fluid causes an increase in the pressure within the pericardial space. As that pressure increases within the pericardial space, it begins to squeeze the heart and cause increased pressure within the heart itself. When the pressure inside the heart increases, blood cannot enter the heart as easily during diastole. Therefore, there is less blood for the heart to pump and hence decreased stroke volume, so the cardiac output decreases as well. Remember that cardiac output is a product of stroke volume times heart rate, so if stroke volume decreases and heart rate stays the same, then cardiac output must decrease as well. Again, it is important to emphasize that not all pericardial effusions cause cardiac tamponade. In fact, the opposite is true. Most effusions do not cause tamponade. Factors that make a pericardial effusion more likely to cause tamponade include 1, a large volume of fluid, 2, a short period of time over which that fluid accumulates. And 3, a pericardial membrane that is very stiff and will not stretch much as the fluid accumulates. Some patients, particularly those with cancer, as mentioned before, may have very large pericardial effusions that accumulate over very long periods of time and hence do not cause tamponade. Because they accumulate over a long time, the pericardium has time to stretch and to accommodate the excess fluid. Conversely, a trauma patient may collect a much smaller amount of fluid in the pericardial space over a matter of seconds to minutes, and even though this is a smaller amount of fluid than the cancer patient, this may result in tamponade. You've probably heard that an important part of becoming a physician is the ability to distinguish the sick from the not sick patients. While patients with cardiac tamponade are sick, they essentially have a form of cardiogenic shock in which the heart cannot adequately pump blood to the rest of the body. As a result, these patients may feel lightheaded or even experience syncope. They may be confused or agitated. On physical exam, the hallmark sign of cardiac tamponade is Beck's triad. You've probably heard of this and you need to remember this because you'll be tested on it in the future. This is the trio of signs of hypotension, which is due to decreased cardiac output, distended jugular veins, because blood cannot enter the heart as easily due to the increased pressure within the heart, and hence the jugular venous pressure increases, and finally distant or muffled heart sounds, because the pericardial effusion creates a layer of fluid between the heart and the chest wall, so heart sounds are softer when auscultated with a stethoscope. Patients will often be tachycardic, which is the body's attempt to preserve cardiac output. Remember, cardiac output equals heart rate times stroke volume. Their hands and feet may feel cool to the touch due to impaired cardiac output and decreased perfusion of the distant extremities. Another important clinical sign is pulsus paradoxus, or a decrease in the systolic blood pressure by more than 10 millimeters of mercury during inspiration as compared to during expiration. It is normal for a person's systolic blood pressure to decrease slightly during inspiration, but usually it decreases by less than 10 millimeters of mercury. This occurs because when you take a deep breath, you decrease your intrathoracic pressure, it becomes more negative, and more blood can return to the heart and fill the right ventricle. Remember that fluid likes to flow from areas of higher pressure to lower pressure. As the right ventricle becomes more distended with fluid, it pushes the interventricular septum slightly to the left and decreases the volume of the left ventricle, which as a result decreases the cardiac output and hence the blood pressure during that beat. With cardiac tamponade, with the increase of blood to the right ventricle cannot expand outward due to the pressure from the pericardial space. Therefore, the right ventricle can only expand more towards the left, impeding the left ventricular space. As a result, the volume of blood in the left ventricle will be even less, and the systolic blood pressure as well as the cardiac output from that left ventricle will be even less on that beat. This is the definition of pulsus paradoxus, or a decrease in the systolic blood pressure by more than 10 millimeters of mercury during inspiration. You may ask, how do you diagnose cardiac tamponade? Well, there's not a single clinical sign or symptom or one single test that can definitively diagnose this. Rather, the diagnosis relies on a combination of clinical suspicion and several diagnostic tests. Echocardiogram is the most common tool used to assist in the diagnosis. However, any cardiologist will tell you that an echocardiogram may simply suggest or support the diagnosis of cardiac tamponade, but cannot diagnose it on its own. An echocardiogram is a good test to see a pericardial effusion. The diagnosis of tamponade is supported when the right atrium, or the right ventricle in more severe cases, collapses during diastole due to the high intrapericardial pressure squeezing it. A right heart catheterization may also be useful, but takes much longer to perform than a simple bedside echocardiogram. Hence, a right heart catheterization is usually reserved only for borderline or questionable cases. However, equalization of pressures in several chambers of the heart during right heart catheterization also supports the diagnosis of cardiac tamponade. As we mentioned previously, cardiac tamponade is an urgent or emergent condition that is potentially life-threatening. Once it is diagnosed, it must be swiftly treated. Treatment can be divided into short-term, immediate measures that will help support the patient until definitive treatment takes place, and then definitive treatment used to relieve the tamponade. If you do not have immediate access to surgery or pericardiocentesis, then short-term medical therapy that can help the patient often starts with intravenous fluids and potentially inotropes such as dobutamine, both of which work to increase the cardiac output. Patients will often be tachycardic, which is the body's way of trying to preserve cardiac output, and in general you should allow them to be tachycardic. Therefore, avoid beta blockers or other drugs that would slow the heart down. In addition, do not give them diuretics or any medicines that may decrease their blood pressure or preload. However, none of these measures will fix the tamponade. They just help support the patient until definitive therapy arrives. In simple terms, the pericardial fluid must be drained from around the heart in order to reverse the tamponade. If it is an emergent condition and there is no time to get to the operating room, then the fastest way to do this is with pericardiocentesis. This is a procedure in which a needle is inserted under the xiphoid process, or alternatively through the chest, until it pierces the pericardial space and the fluid is aspirated out. If the patient does not require emergent drainage, then in some cases it can be better for the cardiothoracic surgeons to take the patient to the operating room and perform a pericardial window, in which they cut a hole in the pericardial membrane and insert a catheter that can drain the pericardial fluid. A pericardial window is useful in cases where long-term drainage is needed. It may also be useful to help diagnose the cause of the pericardial effusion, since the piece of pericardium can be sent to the lab and looked under the microscope for possible clues as to the cause of the effusion. Regardless of the method in which the fluid is drained, that fluid can also be sent to the lab for clues as to the diagnosis of the effusion. In summary, there are many causes of pericardial effusions. However, most of these effusions do not cause cardiac tamponade. Tamponade results in a life-threatening reduction in cardiac output, and its diagnosis is based on clinical and echocardiographic evidence. Once the diagnosis is made, cardiac tamponade requires urgent intervention in order to relieve the tamponade and save the patient. References listed.